there, Internet. Mog White here, and I got another Legends of Runeterra video for you guys today. And today we are going to play some dragons, though not really, because this deck only has 6 dragons, but quite a bit of dragon synergy within it. So let me explain LT Dragon and what this list is all about, because yes, I am playing a dragon deck without Shyvana. I'm going to start the deck tech by, you know, clarifying this, because otherwise I know I'm gonna get a million comments asking me why I'm playing a dragon deck without Shyvana. Even though some smart asses would be like, oh, lol, or, you know, Shyvana is not good, not even good enough for her own dragon archetype, Omega lol, etc. You know, like, I know those type of comments are coming out too. Shyvana is not as bad as some people are claiming her to be. I think it's a result of a bit of an echo chamber happening. So people are just like repeating what others are saying as, you know, their own opinions, and they're saying, well, Shyvana is not good, and Shyvana is actually fine, guys. Shyvana is a strong champion. Her archetype hasn't proven to be tier 1, but it is competitive, and it is fine. Like, I don't think she has not struck me as like underpowered by any means, even though some people have that opinion. I feel like most of people who are saying that are just kind of like echoing that stuff, right? Regardless, I don't run Shyvana in this deck because, like I mentioned prior, I'm only running a total of 6 dragons in this mid-range deck. So what is this deck then, if it's not a dragon deck entirely? And why are you focusing on dragon synergy? Why are you like kind of like doing a little bit of everything in that regard and not just going all in with that? Because the reality, Timmy, is that a lot of times decks don't build themselves. And what I mean by this is, yes, I could make another all-in dragon deck that is relatively easy to deck build, but just because there are certain cards that have synergies with certain types doesn't mean the entire deck has to be comprised of that, you know? Sometimes you take a little bit of a specific synergy and you're incorporated into a mid-range deck with the intentions of having a solid game plan and curve that can work out regardless of your draw patterns with cards that provide you value on their own. In order to do that, you need to know exactly how much of that synergy to incorporate alongside these other mid-range components. It's a process called deck building, right? And it's more complicated than people think sometimes, you know? Like, no, I don't have to. Every deck that I put in Dragon Lieutenant, I don't have to put in every dragon under the sun in the deck. You know? I wanted to start off the video with this because it's a question that I get really often by more inexperienced players, and it can get a little bit repetitive. So I want to clarify there. So what we have here is a mid-range Demacia list with a bit of support from Targon that is heavily based on single combat-based removal. So we have single combat and Concerted Strike as a full set each, and then a couple of Strafing Strike as well as extra copies of single combat. So we have fast-based removal that is based on striking, right? Which is why we are running a full set of Garen, because Garen with a deck which what is basically 8 different versions of single, or 8 versions of single combat, is very easy to level up, right? We can attack with them the moment we play him, and then all we need to do is a Concerted Strike or a single combat, and we get to strike with him again, and we level him up. And leveling up Garen in a mid-range beefy deck like this can be very devastating for the opponent, as we have a very strong unit with regeneration on Garen himself, but then we have all these dragons and this late-game powerhouses combined with our early game challengers to remove the blockers out of the way, which allow us to push some serious damage. And that's the general consensus of this deck. We play big beefy dudes, and we have our little dudes challenge away the blockers so we can hit them directly in the face with our massive power stats. So our challengers are the Fleet Feather Tracker, the Dragon Guard Lieutenant, and then a one-off of Fiora and a couple of Lauren Protege. Instead of running triple Lauren Protege, I get to put in one Fiora because I do have that champion slot, and she is a little bit better than Lauren Protege because of her attack stat. And the reason why we're able to afford Fiora is because we're only running 2 copies of Aurelion Soul, because we are playing 3 copies of Dragon's Clutch, which we are using in the same fashion that Aurelion Soul Trundle Ramp does. We are using Dragon's Clutch to draw specific dragons, but we have a very, very small variety of that, as we have a couple of Eclipse Dragons, the Infamous Mind Splitter, and of course Aurelion Soul in there. We're playing Eclipse Dragon so that we can ramp into Aurelion Soul on turn 8. So we play this on turn 7 with a Daybreak, and then we play an 8 mana Aurelion Soul, and we get him 2 turns earlier without having to do any sort of Wording Stones a catalyst of Aeon's shenanigans, you know? We just get to curve out naturally with that, and I like the design of this dragon a lot. I undermined the hell out of this card at first because I didn't even think about the synergy with Aurelion Soul because I barely play Aurelion Soul, so that didn't even cross my mind. But ever since Aurelion Soul has been nerfed, he's super fine as a champion, man. Now, he doesn't feel silly in the late game. Like, you have to work for that level up. You actually have to work for it. And it feels super rewarding when you achieve it and you are able to go turbo mode. Now, some of you may be asking, why not play some star shaping here and there? I can use Eclipse Dragon if I want to generate Celestials with my Nightfall. And I feel like it's more important for me to have my spells dedicated to either drawing through my deck or, most importantly, interacting with the opponent's creatures, which is why I'm not running star shaping in this build specifically. Infinite Mind Splitter is there alongside these two because it is the premier counter to Lee Sin, amongst many other things. Also, with the rally effects from Garen, we are able to really capitalize on a unit that's basically removing two blockers, as we are going to be attacking every turn. And it's just overall a really strong card that we are incorporating into this deck because we can even play we can use Eclipse Dragon with Infinite Mind Splitter as well to combine it with like a 2-drop in the process. And we're also running a full set of Radiant Guardian. Yes, she got nerfed. Yes, she's not great against pretty much anything mid-range or control, but against aggro, she's an auto win if she's developed on the board, pretty much. And there is a lot of aggro in the ladder right now. There's, you know, Elise variants of Spider aggro. There's Jinx Draven discard. There's, of course, Pirate aggro as well. There's a lot of very fast-paced, mean, aggressive decks that are looking to end the game in, like, the first few turns. And we need the ability to get back versus those. Because otherwise, while we do have a nice curve early on with challengers, we don't have the best way to deal with spread out board states. And Radiant Guardian helps us out in that. And because of the high prevalence of that archetype or that strategy in the ladder right now, we are running her as a full set just because she's our win card against those. Against the other decks, she's still, you know, is decent. But obviously the nerf is definitely noticeable as we're not able to trade into 5/5s anymore, amongst other things, which is a little bit sad, but she's still a must because of the current metagame environment. If things change, then I would definitely tone her down in this build or even not play her at all. But, you know, half the meta's aggro now, so you gotta play Radiant Guardian. And that is the deck list right there. Big shout outs to the Dragon Guard Lieutenant. Such a cool card. I love everything about this card. And I really like the fact that I can work for this synergy without having to make an all-in dragon deck, right? Also, best voice actor in the game, in my opinion. Like, his voice is so epic, and I probably repeat that throughout this video too. So that's all I gotta say. If you guys have any other questions regarding the deck, let me know in the comment section down below. Very solid, good stuff mid-range list with a lot of striking-based removal that can allow us to rally and just overwhelm the opponent with our big boy lizards. And I got some solid gameplay for you guys as I did a live recording with this because I made a lot of misplays with this deck in my stream yesterday. Even though we did climb with this through ranked, it was a bit of a bumpy or a rough climb really because of a lot of mistakes that I made. I wasn't on the top of my game yesterday. It happens sometimes. So I wanted to record a live session with this to showcase this deck and its full potential. And hopefully today's games are rewarding for you to watch in that sense. And that's all I gotta say. Have a solid day. Thank you guys for watching. Stay tuned for daily Legends of Runeterra content as I do post a new deck every single day. Have a great day and a good start of the week. And I'll see you guys tomorrow. All right, here we go. So some War Mother's Call right off the bat. We are gonna have to make use of our aggression here. And we gotta keep in mind that, you know, Avalanche is a thing. So if we want to spread out, we got to be careful with that. I'm going to go ahead and drop a Single Combat and the Radiant Guardian. I'm going to keep one Single Combat alongside my Fiora to potentially push for a kill on the Wording Stones if they do curve out into it. Because I got my boy. I like how he shoots all the way over there. No early plays. We draw into double Eclipse Dragon, which is not ideal considering we're drawing a few too many dragons here, unfortunately. They would fall by my blade. There's the Warding Stones. For the honor of Olga. I'm gonna challenge the Warding Stones here.
Nice to meet you.
And I believe I definitely want to play you, and I think single combat is the way to go. I'm thinking about whether to use single combat or to use my Strafing Strike now that I can, you know, actually afford a 3 mana play, but I would like to carry off some mana here. As we also begin to threaten him as well.
If only Fiora could see me now.
She can. She's not in front.
Oh, that hurts. That hurts. I feel you, bro. Oh, no. It happens. Get rejected. Alright, we're gonna go for a Dragon's Clutch because we're drawing very poorly here. We're drawing too many. We're literally drawing all of our dragons. Like, we actually drew all of our dragons, except we have one Aurelion Soul in our deck, which means this clutch is actually pretty worthless at this point. Let's go you.
Never again will we fall to Dragon Fire.
I know I say this a lot, man, but the Dragon Guard Lieutenant has the most epic voice line in the game, period. It's not even a contest. I could attack here and sacrifice one of my challengers for some damage. Because I'm not really applying pressure here, but I would like to also, like, the problem is the threat of Icequake is also very real. I'm gonna pass. Just because he's not really, like, he's got a lot of mana to work with, and 5 damage feels like quite a bit, but in this matchup, it's very easy for him to recover that, so I may as well let him play into the passive game here. As I am going to Eclipse Dragon. I could threaten with Inner Ruin, so I'll level up next turn. I could always exchange with that. I'm gonna pass here. Make him doubt. He could be looking at a War Mother's Call here. Vile Feast plus Ruination is pretty brutal if he is playing that. But I definitely do just want to go for Aurelion Soul here, I think.
Your favorite star.
I
created it.
And Vile Feast. I could play the Great Beyond, but I think I'm better off. I mean, the problem with this line of play, I'm gonna go with the Eclipse Dragon. There's an Alpha Wall Claw, okay. I do have the ability to Concerted Strike this, but I don't think I want to.
Another day guarding the walls.
I'm okay with these two trading. Needs Vile Feast into Vengeance.
The cosmos will collapse. Hello, good Terra. Let's rock.
Vile Feast into that.
To arms!
I'm gonna attack with my Phoenix here. I'm thinking about what to do, and I'm really I'm gonna play the Infinite Mind Splitter to deny this Tryndamere from attacking. If he does respond with something like a Vengeance, which is what he needs to remove something like this, then I can single combat in response, which means that I will be able to take down leveled up Tryndamere with a Concerted Strike. Alright. That is fine. Alright, this guy's going in. If he plays Avalanche now, I do have Dragon's Clutch to allow me to survive here. I don't think I can kill him this turn, no matter what I do. So I'm gonna try to go for the open attack.
Nothing's tougher than a troll. Back.
We're gonna do it like that. And then we're gonna play the Great Beyond, and we're gonna attempt to go all in here. We have the ability to counter an atrocity as he heals up. And we got him, baby! There we go! Woo! Wow, we beat War Mothers after it goes off. Whoa, wow. That game. We also drew like really bad. I was pretty silent at one point. I was like really focused. Trying to see if there was like an actual way to win that game, because it felt so unwinnable. Especially like after they played the War Mothers and they managed to stabilize like that, especially considering we drew really, really poorly. Like, just so you guys understand, like, we have a total of 6 dragons in our deck and we drew 5. So when we play, like, we drew like 2 dragons clutch. This card was actually really, really clutch, you know, pun intended, at saving us right there. But we had like no early game, no pressure whatsoever. It was a very, very clunky curve, but we still managed to take it. So pretty proud of that one. So yeah, without further ado, let's go for another one. That was a long first game. And I have the hiccups. So yeah. All right, round 2. Go Yu-Gi-Oh! Pro is our next opponent. I like the name. Obviously. Let's go ahead and drop Garen. It may be a little bit early for him. I'm gonna keep everything else here, as this is a very good looking curve to interact with the opponent's board. Obviously, we are facing Lee Sin, so. That could be Diana. Temperamental as moonlight.
Find your own light within the darkness.
Mr. Yu-Gi-Oh! Pro here tried to bait me there. If I play this, it's gonna go down anyways. I probably should just spread out.
Your heretic.
Oh, we got a triple, baby.
You're covered.
Even if he has Pale Casket in hand, I don't see how he's gonna be able to enable the Nightfall, so it will be it won't generate him card advantage here if he does opt to go for it. Well, this Brightsteel Protector play allows us to be pretty aggressive here. I'm gonna keep my Challengers in the back. I don't need to trade my bird with that. Even though I could push some damage, I can always target that with Fiora later down the line. And I can always use these Flea Feather Trackers to also enable my Radiant Guardian. We have to be careful though, because unfortunately, even though we have a pretty low curve, we're not really able to, because of this one drop here, because I should be more aggressive, right? Like, I should push for damage. But I feel like I can get more value out of these trackers. Maybe getting the damage in was important. I'm honestly not sure, but like cards like Guiding Touch just really nullify that attack.
Enter, traveler, and stop staring.
So we're not worried about Lee Sin coming down here because it won't be able to challenge. I mean, we're still worried about it, don't get me wrong. But it wouldn't be the end of the world. You know, I would be more of a fan of his name if he wasn't just spamming the most broken deck. Like, I'm at a point where I'm just like, whenever I see people just spamming Lee Sin, it's just like, I don't think anything of them as players, if that makes any sense. Like I could not be like least impressed by somebody than by somebody who just like spams a champion that is clearly broken, right? To climb, like, I don't know. It's nice though, because I don't run into this deck like super often, because there's other people with integrity in that sense, which is nice. We're gonna block here. because now we do want to start pushing for damage. And now we're going to use our tracker. Like, honestly, I could have just used my tracker earlier and traded with this. I didn't know like the game was going to turn out like that, right? But maybe that would have been a good trade anyways. Well, let's just go for this. We're going face here. And we're gonna drop the Radiant Guardian, which can help us.
I taste purple. Yay.
A little bit with our current life status here. Concerted Strike would also be a really nice draw, even though I would assume that he has something to counter it at this point. If he goes for a Zenith Blade now, then he only has one left. Which is a bit of a risky commitment to make. Okay.
I long for a worthy opponent.
I'm gonna try to go for a strike here. I'm not going to trade with a Dustbringer here, because I am going to get that health back. Instead, I am going to go for an all-in attack here. Capitalizing on my challengers to remove this blocker out of the way. My opponent still has 4 mana open.
They forced us to choose death or flame.
There's another Dustbringer there. Okay. We just survive one more turn.
We each hold a world within.
That's basically what we gotta do. He needs one more spell to enable that. He can go for a gem.
Yeah.
Cause he wants the thing. Like, the thing is, if he attacks, I will block with the Eclipse Dragon. To gain the Fury boost.
Lunari, rise. Hold back the darkness. Stay back.
I can take this hit. I can actually take this hit. And then develop the Infinite Mind Splitter. The Infinite Mind Splitter alongside this.
My shield is yours.
He's playing Infinite Mind Splitter. All right.
never hold back. On guard!
You cannot sway me.
I have to attack like this. So I definitely wasn't expecting the infinite mind splitter there. That's the last thing I was expecting, honestly. Like, my game plan was to use my own mind splitter to shut him down here and go for the kill with this. The more I think about it, though, the more I regret my initial line of play.
Hello.
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 I mean, if he has something like a Will of Ionia. Like, I don't want to drop my Radiant Guardian here. Okay, there's no more threat of Will of Ionia.
Justice will be served.
So I am going to develop a Radiant Guardian, which is the closest thing to keep me alive here. And then I would feel really nice if I drew into... Okay, Hush is ideal. I just need... Okay, if I see Lee Sin... I can just hush it immediately. Hush is actually like a pretty life-saving card here, because we're going to try to win with Aurelion Soul. We have the board state for it. We were definitely not expecting the Infinite Mind Splitter. That threw us off like really hard. But we can still win this game, potentially. Okay.
Off we go.
All right, he's trying to go for that.
It's our time.
Hold back the darkness.
That's 7, 8, 15. That's perfect still. Still not enough. I'm gonna deny you all that, brother. Gonna deny you all that, brother! No health gain for you. And we got just the board state for ya, boy. I created it, bitch! There we go! Oh, nice! Oh, what a game, dude. Okay, so there was like no Lee Sin in that match, but the Infinite Mind Splitter, that came out of nowhere, man. Like, that's not a card. I don't know. Maybe people are starting to run it. I mean, the thing about Infinite Mind Splitter is that it counters Lee Sin in the mirror, right? So that could very well be a tech for the mirror match, but it really threw me off for a loop there. Just always expect the unexpected, even in card games, I guess. All right, let's go for another one. All right, we're facing Shisu. We could have like at the core, we have a pretty similar sort of deck, but we're utilizing Garen and Challengers instead of Leona. I do think I want to keep a one-off of Garen here. I like the Concerted Strike as well, but I'm going to keep Garen in a single combat. I actually like Garen in this matchup. And we draw into the perfect one drop and two drop.
Ours is the one true light.
Do I take the hit from this? And now we're going to utilize the Protector.
You're covered.
We're going to cover our bird from harm's way.
Honor guide me.
And we're going in. To get some nice card advantage and board advantage going on, and even the odds regarding damage. Wow. Oh. He does prevent damage, but we got a single combat out of him, which is actually really huge here. And we have your boy. We wear red to honor the fallen. I know I've said it like 47,000 times, man. I just fucking love this guy's voice. Smack him for 5. And we're gonna get some card draw as well. Now we have a hand that's the same size.
Behold the sun's holy light.
Your kind will answer for Renwall.
Next turn, we're gonna be playing Garen here.
Bask in her radiant blessing.
For justice.
For Demacia. I'm gonna drag this with my tracker because Pale Cascade could be a thing. Pale Cascade could still be a thing.
Come hither, you beasts of glory!
Yeah, I can't single combat if I have Pale Cascade.
How do you wield such a clumsy weapon?
With justice and honor.
I am the bulwark against darkness.
The Herald of Dragons putting in a massive work here, allowing me to ramp into the Mind Splitter. Even though we know Aurelion Soul can be coming next turn, we are aiming to shut him down. This also allows us to, we can single combat here easily.
Blinding daylight.
I mean, I will block. I'm gonna block here.
I stand ready.
Waiting for the Pale Cascade, yep. I think I should do this. I level up Garen.
This will be quick.
Now, if I draw another Garen, it will be leveled up. We're going in.
Prepare for battle.
No mercy.
I do love an audience. So much for their pedestrian tricks. Heavens diminish without my attention.
Such majesty.
I'm gonna single combat here. If he Pale Cascades, we do have Dragon's Clutch. Gotcha. I got him! Got him, baby!
Victory today, freedom tomorrow.
Eventually we'll break free. There we go, boy! Wow, that's a nice that's a nice win streak there. Oh man, we didn't get to showcase Garen as much, even though you guys can understand how he's really good in this deck with all the striking. Like, he's very easy to level up, and threatening our opponent with rallies every turn, or an attack rather, every turn, is extremely powerful with a deck that curves out into such big dudes like this. Infinite Mind Splitter, just really strong as usual. Very, very powerful against the meta as well in general. Being one of the few, like, legit answers to Lee Sin is a very strong trait for a card to have. And definitely put in the work with Dragon Guard Lieutenant. One of the cards that I wanted to showcase the most with this deck, really. I want this guy for the thumbnail because I don't know. I really like this card. It's nothing, like, too crazy, right? It's just a 2-drop with Challenger, right? But I like the way that it's designed. I like the requirement. I like the payoff. I love the voice line. And I love the art as well. I don't know. It's just dope as hell for me. Maybe that's just me. Herald of the Dragons, even. Like, that was the big breaking point. Like, she seems like a little bit off here as a one-off, but she goes a long way. Allowing me to curve out into these big boys, like, one turn earlier is just such a big deal. And that's basically the deck list right there. Very, very intense and fun games today. Even though it was only 3 games, they were pretty damn long each. So hopefully you guys enjoyed today's video. Leave a like if you did, and let me know what decks or, you know, cards you want to see, as I am working already on Vault of Helia, and I'm also working on a new Undying deck as well. And I got some other ideas that I'm going to be jumping into as well. Like, I definitely want to build a deck with Trevor's Newsbottom. There's still quite a bit to explore. And pretty excited for it, man. I'm having a lot of fun with this expansion, honestly. Like, if I'm really honest with you, I mean, really, you're either honest or you're dishonest, right? Like, if I'm honest with you, I like this expansion more than the original batch of Call of the Mountain. I feel like, you know, the fact that the dragon archetype is completed is really nice. I feel like Tom Kench is fantastic design, and Soraka is also phenomenal as a design. And there's some really, really interesting archetypes. I love landmarks. I feel like the original, you know, batch of, like, or the initial package of Call of the Mountain was a bit too vanilla for my taste, since I'm not the biggest fan of Daybreak, Leona, and Nightfall mechanics. Nightfall is a bit more interesting, but Daybreak is just really boring to me. So I'm very happy that I definitely like these new cards more, is what I'm trying to say. And I'm having a lot of inspiration, not only to build new decks, but revisit old ones and make them better, which is also just as fun for me, honestly. So yeah, I'm going to stop talking because I'm rambling at this point. But yeah, love you guys. Thank you guys for watching. Stay tuned for daily content. And I'll see you tomorrow.